Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Insignificant Events in the Life of a Cactus by Dusti Bowling. Narrated by Karissa Vacker. 1. When I was little, a kid pointed at me on the playground and shouted, "Her arms fell off!" Then ran away screaming in terror to his mom, who had to cuddle him on her lap and rub his head for like 10 minutes to get him to calm down. I think, up until then, I hadn't thought about the idea that my arms must have actually fallen off at some point in my life. I had never really thought about not having arms at all. My missing arms weren't an issue for me or my parents. I never once heard either of them say, "Oh no, Aven can't possibly do that because that's only for armed people," or, "Poor Aven is so helpless without arms," or, "Maybe Aven can do that one day, you know, if she ever grows some arms." They always said things like, "You'll have to do this differently from other people, but you can manage," and, "I know this is challenging, keep trying," and, "You're capable of anything, Aven." I had never realized just how different I was until the day that horrible kid shouted about my arms having fallen off. For the first time, I found myself aware of my total armlessness, and I guess I felt like I was sort of naked all of a sudden. So I, too, ran to my mom, and she scooped me up and carried me away from the park, allowing my tears and snot to soak her shirt. As she drove us home that day, I sat whimpering in my car seat and asked her what had happened to my arms and why they'd fallen off. She told me they hadn't fallen off. I was just born like that. I asked her how I could get some new ones. She said I couldn't. I wailed in despair, and she told me to stop crying because having arms was totally overrated. I didn't know what overrated meant at the time because, like I said, I was really little and so was my brain. I kind of figured it out over the next few days, though, because my parents were constantly saying things like, "Coloring this picture with my hands is okay, but if only I could color it with my feet like Aven. Now that would be fantastic." And, "Eating spaghetti with my arms is just so boring. I wish I could eat it with my feet." And, "The only person I know who can pick their nose with their toes is Aven. She sure is a special little girl." Dad even went so far as to ask Mom if there were any arm removal services in the area. Growing up, I could do most everything everyone else with arms could do. Eating cereal, brushing my teeth and hair, getting dressed, and, yes, even wiping my own bottom. I know you're instantly wondering how I do it, and maybe I'll tell you later. Maybe. Until then, you'll just have to live in suspense. Sure, these things take longer for me. Sometimes they take a lot longer. Sometimes I have to use a special tool like a hook or a strap or something like that. And every now and then, I want to scream in frustration and kick a pillow until the stuffing comes out because it's taken me 20 minutes to get my pants buttoned. But I can button my pants. I think I can do all these things because my parents have always encouraged me to figure things out on my own. Well, more like made me figure things out on my own. I suppose if they had always done everything for me, I would be helpless without them. But they didn't, and I'm not. And now that I'm 13 years old, I don't need much help with anything. True story. When I started kindergarten, the kids were a little weirded out by my lack of armage. I got asked just about every day what had happened to my arms, as well as a billion other silly questions, like, how do I make farting noises with my armpits when I don't have arms or hands? Or pits. And how do I play dress-up? Which I tried showing them and ended up with a poofy pink tutu thing stuck around my head for about 5 minutes before the teacher finally noticed and helped me pull it down to my waist. I got so tired of telling them the same boring story about being born without arms that I started making stuff up. It was stinking hilarious. I knew from the first moment I told a girl my arms had burned off in a fire, I had found a great hobby, making up stories. I loved the way her eyes grew wide with the shock and the way her voice went all high-pitched with excitement as she asked me a bunch more questions about my charred arms. Her. What kind of fire accident? Me. A wild forest fire burning out of control? Her. Where? Me. In the mountains of Tanzania. I honestly didn't know where Tanzania was or if it had any mountains. I think I had heard the name in an episode of Scooby-Doo or something. Her. How old were you? Me. Just a helpless baby. My mom barely rescued me in time. She pulled me from my burning crib and raced out of our flaming village, leaving a trail of fire all the way down the mountain as my arms burned to a crisp. They looked like two pieces of bacon by the time we got to the village hospital. Another kid standing nearby. Cooked or uncooked? So I kind of traumatized her and had to have a meeting with my parents and the teacher later about my story. My parents squinted their eyes and pursed their lips and nodded their heads as the teacher told them, Aven told another child that her arms burned off in a wildfire in the mountains of Tanzania. She peered at them over her glasses, frowning. She also mentioned something about bacon. I had never seen such serious looks on my parents' faces before, like they were concentrating so hard on being serious, their heads might explode if they blinked. They said seriously they would talk to me about it and shook the teacher's hand seriously and gave me serious looks as we walked seriously out of school. But I could tell they weren't mad because all the way home, one of them would softly snort and then the other would giggle and then the other would shake from laughing but trying not to laugh out loud and on like that all the way home. They later told me just to be truthful so I didn't upset any other kids. And I did for a long time. But then one day in fifth grade, we had a new kid come to our school. I had gone to the same school since kindergarten, so all my friends knew I was just born with no arms. When I sat down at lunch with this kid, he said, "Whoa, what happened to your arms?" All my friends were looking at me, and what can I say? It exploded out of me like an overfilled water balloon. I told him this crazy story about how I had rescued a puppy that had been tied to the train tracks just in time before a train nearly ran over it. Just in time for the puppy, but not for my poor, flattened arms. You should have seen the look on this kid's face. Priceless. My best friend, Emily, burst out laughing, and my friend Kayla spit chocolate milk across the table. The new kid realized it was a joke and started laughing too. Pretty soon, everyone was constantly asking me, "Hey, Aven, where'd your arms go?" And I would have a new story to tell. Over time, my stories got more and more ridiculous. Alligator wrestling in the Everglades in Florida, freak roller coaster accidents, skydiving trips gone wrong. I made my stories as ridiculous as possible so people would always know I was joking. I grew up with those kids. I never felt out of place or anything like that. My armlessness wasn't strange or weird to them because, like I said, I had always gone to the same school. I never imagined my parents would make me leave. I never thought they would make me move all the way to Arizona and go to a new school right after starting eighth grade. Then again, I never imagined I would save the Old West, perform for an audience in the desert, and solve a mystery. You'd be surprised at all I'm capable of, though, even without arms. 2. The day Dad told me he wanted to apply for a job as a theme park manager in Arizona, I thought it was quite possible aliens had taken over his brain. Either aliens or the government. I knew from my great-grandma the government was capable of dreadful things. She was always saying stuff like, "If the public only knew what the government was up to, there would be a revolution," and pumping her spotted, wrinkled fist in the air. I wasn't completely sure why an 86-year-old woman who lived in a trailer in Kansas was the only person privy to this top secret information, but she clearly was. So I wouldn't put it past the government to insert some kind of mind-controlled chip into Dad's brain and force him to run a crumbling theme park in the desert. My parents discussed it with me one night over a dinner of buttered noodles, my favorite meal. Oh man, I just realized they deliberately buttered me up with buttered noodles. So I got an email from a guy by the name of Joe Kavanaugh, Dad said over his noodles. He owns a place called Stagecoach Pass. What's that? I asked, slurping up a noodle.
It's this Western-themed amusement park in Arizona. I guess he found my resume on one of the job sites where I posted it. Anyway, he invited me to apply for the position of general manager at the park.
He must have been impressed with your resume, Mr. Big Time Restaurant Manager, said Mom.
Well, said Dad, I'm not really sure how managing a restaurant relates to managing an entire theme park, but I guess a huge part of their business is this steakhouse there, so that's probably why he contacted me.
Are you going to apply? I asked.
It does sound interesting, said Dad.
I scowled. Arizona is really far away.
Don't forget you were born there, Sheebs,
Dad said.
We spent a lot of time there during your adoption, and we really liked it. We even thought it might be a great place to retire one day. The winter was so beautiful, warm and sunny. I'm sick of icy winters.
What's the summer like? I asked. Mom grimaced. I've heard it's kind of like the surface of the sun.
It could be an exciting adventure.
Dad waggled his eyebrows at me.
Swimming and soccer all year long.
I glared at my noodles. I don't think I want to play soccer on the surface of the sun.
Come on, said Dad. You're such a pro, you could play soccer anywhere.
Stop trying to entice me, I said. You haven't even applied yet.
Well, if it's okay with you, I'd like to.
On the one hand, the thought of leaving Kansas and the only home I could ever remember sounded worse than anything. On the other, Dad had lost his job nearly 6 months earlier when the restaurant he'd been managing went out of business. He really needed this. It's okay with me, I mumbled, feeling like I might cry. Dad applied. And then he and Mom were invited to go to Arizona for an interview and to check the place out. And then they were invited to stay and run the theme park together. Turns out it was more of a two-person job. And so we sold off a ton of our furniture and donated the junk we didn't need and packed the rest of our belongings into a giant pod that would magically disappear from Kansas and magically reappear in Arizona a week later. We drove our old car over 1,000 miles westward across the country, praying the entire time we wouldn't break down. We managed to make it in one single long day without stopping at a hotel until we got to Phoenix. By the time we arrived, Dad's eyes looked like atomic fireballs, and Mom's hair looked like she'd taken a spin in a hairspray cyclone. Early the next morning, we drove by the giant covered wagon with Stagecoach Pass printed on it in large brown block letters, and I saw the park for the first time. Then I knew for sure the government and mind control chips were involved. 3. We parked in the large dirt parking lot and got out of the car. I squinted from the bright hot sun. Had the sun been this bright in Kansas? I didn't think so. I looked around. I'd never seen so much brown before, not a patch of grass anywhere. Did grass even exist in Arizona? Again, I didn't think so. We walked over the compacted dirt toward the entrance, which wasn't closed up even though the park wasn't open yet. I guess they weren't too worried about people sneaking in. A lizard skittered across the dirt in front of me, and I jumped back. The dirt never ended.
There were no sidewalks or grass or paved anything at Stagecoach Pass. Just dirt and old wooden buildings with old wooden steps and old wooden porches that looked like they might collapse at any time.
Good morning,
a cheerful gray mustached man greeted us from one of these porches. He wore a cowboy hat and held a mug of something steamy. Coffee? In this heat? Good morning, Mom and Dad said at the same time. Nice to see you again, Gary, said Mom. I looked at her. He's the one who interviewed us, she whispered to me. He's the accountant for the park. Gary walked down the steps.
And this must be Aven. Our one and only,
Dad said, squeezing his arm around me. I gave Gary a polite smile. He seemed nice enough, even though his gray mustache was awfully pointy.
Well,
Gary said, tossing his coffee on the dirt where it dried in about 2 seconds.
I bet you're tired after your long trip. I'll take you up to the apartment.
As we trudged toward our new living quarters, which were apparently located right over the steakhouse, Dad asked,
So when do we get to meet Joe Kavanaugh? Oh, no one ever meets Joe,
said Gary.
Not around here much.
That's strange, said Mom. A business owner who doesn't visit his own business? Gary smiled and tilted his hat at her.
That's why Joe needs good managers, ma'am.
Mom and Dad had described the apartment as a cozy but humble little place. They weren't kidding about the cozy, or the humble, or the little. Gary and a few other men from the park, all dressed like cowboys, carried our stuff up from the car. After Mom and I finished putting away my suitcase of bare necessities, she said to me, Why don't you go out and explore, honey? What's there to explore? Tons of stuff, she said. There's a gold mine and a gift shop and a museum and a soda shop. You could get yourself an ice cream. She looked at her watch. It won't be open for a half hour, though. So I went out and explored for about 5 minutes. The heat got more and more intense with every second until I was forced into the air-conditioned museum. The museum was actually more like a room. Just one room with picture-covered walls and a few artifacts in glass cases. These artifacts included a collection of stone arrowheads, some broken Navajo pottery pieces, a pistol from the 1800s, a pair of old spurs, and a genuine dead tarantula with an information board that shared facts like, tarantulas have no teeth, so they use their venom to liquefy their prey and suck up the liquid nastiness directly into their stomachs. How awesome is that? I scanned the framed photographs on the walls, the old wooden floorboards creaking under my feet. Most of the pictures were black and white, taken a long time ago when Stagecoach Pass first opened. It looked like it was quite the place back then. Crowds and rodeos and even parades on Main Street. Then I came to an empty space on the wall where it seemed a picture had been removed. The nameplate beneath the empty space had been left up and said, The Kavanaughs, Stagecoach Pass, 2004. I looked around at the rest of the photos and each of their nameplates, but I couldn't find any more of the Kavanaughs. I thought about what Gary had said. No one ever meets Joe. And I wondered why.
There you are, Dad said from behind me. I've been looking for you.
I turned around. Just getting some cool air.
Don't worry. Dad wiped the sweat from his forehead. It will cool down soon. Guess what?
What?
The rodeo arena is all closed down, so I thought we could set up a soccer goal out there and practice.
That sounds great.
You want to go kick the ball around now?
Isn't it too hot?
Never. Plus, we can keep cool with ice cream.
What if I get a sunburn?
They have sunblock in the gift shop.
I smiled. You have an answer for everything, don't you? Dad put an arm around me and led me into the gift shop.
Of course. Didn't you know that dads know everything? I snorted as he picked out a small tube of sunblock from a rack. I'd like to be there when you tell Mom that.
4.
Even though the new school year had already started, my parents gave me a couple of days to settle in before sending me off to be tortured. Desert Ridge Middle School was only a few miles from Stagecoach Pass, and Mom drove me my first day. I sat in my seat, staring straight ahead, my heart pounding. When we turned into the parking lot of my new giant school, I thought my heart might just pound right out of my chest. My school back in Kansas only had about 300 students. Desert Ridge was more than 3 times that size. 1,000 kids who had never seen me before. Mom drove our old clunker up to the drop-off curb behind a bunch of other cars, mostly fancy cars like BMWs, Volvos, and Jeeps, all shiny and freshly waxed in a variety of bright colors. Our can't-tell-what-the-color-is car didn't even have a logo because it had fallen off a long time ago. Actually, I'm not sure my parents remembered what kind of car it was. It definitely didn't fit in with the other cars, and I took that as a bad sign. We waited as the line inched forward. Mom turned to me. Her lips twitched a bit as she smiled. "You want me to walk you in?" I shook my head. "No." She nodded and pushed a long strand of dark hair behind her ear. "Yeah, I suppose that would be embarrassing, having your mommy walk you in on your first day. Just a little." She ran her hand down my hair and tugged lightly on the tips. "You remember where your first class is?"
"Yep, no problem."
"You remember where your locker is?"
"All systems go, in my brain," I said as we pulled up right in front of the curb.
"Oh, good," she said, "because I was a little bit worried this morning when you came out with your shirt on backward and then stuck your cereal in the microwave."
"Just being an airhead," I slid my head under the strap of my bag. That wasn't exactly the truth. I was nervous. Extremely nervous.
"I know how hard things have been for you, sweetheart," she said. "I'm fine, Mom, really. I'll be okay today."
She leaned over and kissed the top of my head. "Call if you need anything. I'll pick you up right out here after school."
Normally, my parents never baby me. They're more the kind of parents who, instead of kissing your boo-boos, tell you to walk it off and be a man. And they never have seemed to care that I'm not actually a man. But I guess today was a special occasion. Honestly, I wished she would stop. It was stressing me out even more. I nodded and opened the car door with my foot, then slid it back into my new purple ballet flat. I got out of the car, swung my bag around to my side, gave Mom a reassuring smile, and slammed the door shut with my hip. Before I'd walked 5 steps, I got my first look. I tried to ignore it. My parents had always taught me to tackle one small goal at a time, holding a brush between my toes, lifting that brush all the way to my head, running the brush through my hair. One small goal at a time. And so I zeroed in on my first goal of the day, getting to my first class without barfing up all my soggy, microwaved cereal. We had visited the school yesterday so I could find my classes, meet some of my teachers, and talk with the people in the office. Everyone was super nice and caring, of course, but they all said the same thing so much it started to get annoying. "If there's anything you need, Aven, don't be afraid to ask." Like they just knew I was going to need a lot of extra help. I speed-walked to the science room, not just to avoid the other kids' stares, but also because it was so stinking hot. By the time I got to my class, sweat was already trickling down my forehead. I went straight to my seat, swung my school bag onto my desk, and slid the strap off over my head. I eased my foot out of my flat, opened the top of my bag with it, and pulled out my science book.
One benefit of living in Arizona was that I could wear ballet flats, my favorite kind of shoe, year-round. Not at all like in Kansas, where I had to wear warm boots in the winter. Everything took longer when I wore warm boots. It was so much easier to slip my foot in and out of flats. I had pairs in brown, black, rainbow stripes, flowers, and now purple. Flip-flops probably would have been even easier, but there's the whole dust factor, and it's especially dusty in the desert. I glanced up and found Ms. Hart, the science teacher, watching me. I smiled a little, and she smiled back. I had met her last night, and she had told me to let her know if I needed any help, of course. I hoped she could see now that I didn't need extra help as I proceeded to pull a notebook and pencil out of my bag with my foot. I took my seat and turned to the girl sitting next to me. The girl's eyes widened in obvious surprise.
Are you new?
She asked. Yes, I replied. It's my first day. It stunk to be starting eighth grade over a month into the school year. I could tell the girl was desperately trying not to look at my non-existent arms. People were always doing that. Like, if they looked down at my torso for longer than a split second, they would turn to stone. Like my torso was actually Medusa's head. The girl was pretty, with her long, dark hair and strappy red dress and all her body parts. I always wanted to wear a dress with skinny straps like that, but I guess I felt too self-conscious about it. The strappy dress wouldn't look the same without some nice long arms to show off in it. Well, welcome. She quickly pulled out her books and started reading, surely to avoid having to talk to me anymore. I turned my attention to my own book and then looked back at the girl. What page are we on? I asked her. 23. She reached for my book. Here, I'll help. Oh, no, that's okay, I said. She stopped and pulled her hand away. I lifted my foot and opened the book with it, using my dexterous toes to turn the pages until I got to page 23. See? I can do it. She gave me a twitchy smile. How do you learn to do that? I shrugged. You'd be surprised what you can do with your feet when that's all you have. She gave me another uncomfortable smile and went back to reading her book. She hadn't introduced herself, so I didn't either. I sometimes wondered if people had a tendency not to give me their names or ask me for mine because of their fear of getting too close. Too close to something so different. At lunchtime, I decided to sit outside on a bench to eat. I didn't want to go to the cafeteria and sit at a table by myself while everyone watched me eat with my feet. I might as well have been up on stage with a spotlight shining on me. I pulled my lunch out of my bag, but then I noticed a few kids standing around glancing at me. I knew what they were doing, waiting to watch me eat. Everyone was always curious. At home in Kansas, I'd have been sitting at a table with Emily, Kayla, and Brittany, all of us laughing about the booger hanging out of Mr. Thompson's hairy nose during history class. Kayla would be tossing pretzels at me while I tried to catch them in my mouth, and Emily would be complaining that her parents still wouldn't let her wear makeup. No one would have cared that I was eating with my feet. My stomach cramped. I stuck my lunch back in my school bag and headed for the bathroom, where I was grateful to find automatic water and soap dispensers. In my nervousness, I had forgotten to wash my feet, which I always do before I eat. Just because I don't have arms doesn't mean I'm all gross and want toe jam in my Cheetos. By the time I finished drying them, my stomach cramping had eased, but I didn't feel hungry anymore. I went outside, found a secluded spot under a tree, sat in the grass, and read my science book. 5. I'm sure a lot of people think it would be cool to live inside a theme park. And if that theme park was Disney World, I'm sure they would be right. Though I've never been there, I imagine living in Stagecoach Pass is probably not a whole lot like living in Disney World. It's more like living in Disney Shantytown. We'd moved into the small apartment over the Stagecoach Pass saloon and steakhouse because running a theme park is apparently a 24-hour-a-day job. You never know when an ancient toilet might explode, hopefully not with someone on it, or a kid might get bitten by a crazed bunny. Because the apartment is located right on top of the steakhouse, I can hear the noisy player piano in the bar every night as I fall asleep. The only main course options on the menu at the steakhouse are steak and a burger, both served with cowboy beans, cornbread, and coleslaw. For the adventurous, there is fried rattlesnake or Rocky Mountain oysters for appetizers. I tried the fried rattlesnake on my first day here, and I wasn't all that impressed. It pretty much just tasted like little fried pieces of fried stuff. I didn't much care to try the Rocky Mountain oysters, though. I've had this long-standing rule of not eating private parts, and it's served me well so far. The saloon and steakhouse is the first wooden building you see when you enter Stagecoach Pass after parking in the giant dirt lot, which is only a quarter full on the busiest days. Next to the steakhouse is a shooting gallery, where the fake guns have such poor aim that no one can hit the little bullseyes attached to plastic cactuses, wild-eyed cowboy cutouts, and stuffed, patchy-haired bobcats. Across from the shooting gallery is the tiny museum and the main souvenir shop, which sells things like drink coasters and shot glasses with cactuses on them, lollipops with scorpions inside them. Yeah, like anyone would eat that. And postcards of the Grand Canyon. I guess so people can pretend they visited the Grand Canyon instead of Stagecoach Pass? Not that I blame them. The main dirt road, surprisingly called Main Street, that runs through Stagecoach Pass winds a corner after the shooting gallery, and there stands a theater that shows old black and white westerns all day long. Maybe like one person is always sitting in there, probably just to soak up the air conditioning. Next to the movie theater is the soda shop that sells old-fashioned candy and ice cream. It's run by a white-haired guy named Henry, who's worked there since Stagecoach Pass opened and who never gets anyone's order right. Ask for a single strawberry cone, and he gives you a triple chocolate. He's like 100 years old and completely senile, but he always remembers my name for some reason. I guess I'm pretty memorable. Must be the red hair. If you walk farther down the dirt road.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.